zeta function one of the most hot topic of present mathematics. Most of the people know about this because there is a $1 million prize for anyone who can find the non-trivial zeros of this zeta function. Just hearing about it, I can see a lot of monies. Now, jokes aside, this function is very important in our modern number theory. And why it is important, we will discuss that in this video. In this video, we will understand what is a zeta function and how to extend it to the whole complex plane. What are the zeros and what the zeros mean of this function, and don't worry, I will make you understand what these things are. And also we will understand how these functions zeros are related to the prime numbers. Before starting, I would like to thank Jordan because his article helped me to make this video, and his article will be linked in the description, so check that out. So now let's start our discussion on this zeta function. So the zeta function is defined as something like this. That is, it is an infinite sum of the natural numbers, like this. Now, as we are adding infinitely many terms, the question is it convergent or divergent? That is, does it have a particular value? For this, let's take an example. Let's take x equals to 2. Now, this particular sum is actually converge, and it converges to a very beautiful value of pi square by 6. Now, what do I mean by this? To understand it, let's take a line, a 1D axis, and there I will represent each of these terms as a line with length equal to that term. Now let's plot those lines. Now as you can see, if I keep adding those terms as lines, it approaches to a single point, and that particular point is actually what it converges to, and in this case it's pi square by 6, that is that blue point. Now you can say that in this particular case it's pretty obvious that it will converge because we are keep adding smaller and smaller terms, as you can see. But is it true for any general case that if I keep adding a smaller and smaller terms, it will absolutely converge? To understand it, let's take an example, and a very beautiful one. Let's see it. Now let's take zeta of 1, and this will be equal to this infinite series, and this particular series is called harmonic series. And as you can see, we are adding smaller and smaller terms, as you can see from the values written. So from our previous discussion, you should say that this one will also converge. But sadly, this one actually diverges towards infinity. So from our discussion, we came to this conclusion that the zeta function only converges for its x greater than 1. Now to understand it in much more detail, I will show you a proof. But before that, I will define the zeta function for complex numbers, which are more general than the real numbers. And before understanding this zeta function with complex argument, let's understand what do we mean by complex powers. So now let's understand complex exponents. Before that, let's see what a real exponent does. So let's take a to the power n. Now here, the exponent, that is the n, actually is a real number, this n, and this represent multiplying a certain number of times. So let's write it down as a to the power n equals to multiplication of certain number of a's, and the number of a present here is actually equals to the value of exponent, that is here the number of a is n. So this is what means by a real exponent. Now let's replace that n by a complex number. So let's write it down a to the power z. Here z is a complex number. Let's write it down as x plus iy. So we can write this a to the power z as a to the power x plus iy, like this. Now we can separate it and write a to the power x into a to the power iy. Now the first term represent a number to the power a real number, so we know what that mean, this one. Now let's see what a to the power iy means. So we can write this using the logarithmic function as e to the power of log of a to the power iy, and from this we can write it something like this. So this is e to the power I times some number. So what that mean? Let's take a 2D grid, and rather complex grid. Now we take a phasor which is situated along the x-axis or the real axis, and take a unit circle. So this e to the power I into some term means that we will take a unit phasor and rotate it along the unit circle, and the angle between the phasor and the real axis, that is the yellow angle, is equal to the power of the exponent here. So that means that e to the power some number means actually some rotation. So we can write a to the power z equals to something like this. Here the second term is actually a pure rotation, as I have shown you before. And for the first term, it actually means some kind of scaling. So what we will do, we will first take a unit phasor and rotate it about an angle, and then we will scale it according to the first term, like this. And if the first term is less than 1, then we will just shrink it. So now we understand what complex exponent mean. Now let's see what will be the addition of two complex exponential numbers. Suppose we want to add these two numbers. So from our previous discussion, we can write it as something like this. Now let's draw the 2D plane, and let's take a phasor along the real axis, a phasor of unit length. Now let's rotate it according to the angle of the first part or the first number, something like this. Here the blue angle is equals to y1 log of a. Now we will stretch it according to the a to the power x1. Now for the second term, what we will do, we will take another phasor and we will take its axis equals to the first phasor, that is something like this, and we will rotate it with respect to the first phasor, and that rotated angle is equals to y2 log of b, and then we will scale it according to b to the power x2. Now the resultant of these two addition, or the addition, is equals to the vector from the origin to the tip of the second phasor. Now from the triangular law, we can write it as the length of the yellow phasor is less than or equals to length of the first phasor plus length of the second phasor. Now if we add n numbers with complex exponents, we can write it something like this. So this means that the sum of numbers with complex exponent, that is, it will converge or diverge, represent, or it completely depends on the real exponent. So from this we can say that to judge that a zeta of some number will converge or diverge, we just need to consider its real values of z. Now let's see what do we mean, and let's see a proof of the convergence of zeta function. Now let's use algebra autopilot to see the proof. and this completes our proof of convergence of zeta. Now we know that the zeta function only converges for the real part of z greater than 1. Now from our previous knowledge we can write zeta of z equals to something like this. Here the exponential part represents the rotation. So like previous, I will consider each term as a line, and due to the exponential part they will rotate. So now let's calculate zeta of 2 plus I. So as you can see that if I draw those lines, due to the exponential part they will rotate and the result will be a point on the complex plane. For this case, the zeta of 2 plus I as expected converges, and it converges to this particular point, that is this green point here. And this value of the green point, that is its value, is equals to this particular term. Something like this. If you are curious how I calculated it, actually I have calculated it using a Python program which features the formula described above. Here is the program and you can use it yourself to find out the values of zeta. Now let's see what zeta does to actually the whole complex plane. And it is beautiful. As I have told you before that the zeta function only converges for the real part greater than 1. So let's draw the grid for the real part greater than 1. I have drawn this dense grid for better understanding of transformation. Now let's transform it according to the zeta function. So if we transform it, you see it's truly beautiful. But you see that this is somewhat incomplete. So let's try to complete it. And we do this using a method called analytic continuum, and I will explain it in a short term. So let's see it, what it means. As we know, we can represent the zeta function as something like this, a sum of infinite series. And this series only converges for the real component of S greater than 1. Let's take an example. Let's take zeta of minus 3. This represents a infinite series something like this, and this is obvious that it diverges because we are keep adding bigger and bigger terms. Now to continue it, or the continue zeta function to the left side of the plane, we need a functional equation. I will not go in much detail in this video. And for zeta we have a functional equation something like this. Using this functional equation and the values of zeta for the right side of the plane, we can continue the zeta function to the whole complex plane. So this series, that is the infinite summation series, only makes sense for the real component of S greater than 1. And for the other values, we use the functional equation. For the functional equation case, we don't have any expression of zeta. We just know this functional equation, and we define zeta as something we get from this equation. For an example, let's try to calculate zeta of minus 1. So as you can see, we get something like this, and it can be written as something like this. And if I put the values on of the right side, we get something like this. That is minus of 1/12. Remember one thing. I am not suggesting that something like this is true. No, this is not the case. For the left side of the plane, the summation definition of zeta doesn't make sense. This is not true. This is not the case. I have gotten this value from the functional equation only. There is no expression of zeta for the right side of the left side of the plane. So up until now we have understood that if it is our complex plane, then the zeta function is only defined as an infinite sum for the real part greater than 1. That is, for the yellow plane, the zeta function is defined as an infinite sum of reciprocals of real numbers. The red line is where the zeta function is not defined. And the purple part, that is the purple plane, in this region, the zeta function is defined using a functional equation. which is something like this. In this purple plane, the zeta function is not defined as an infinite sum of the reciprocals of real numbers. No, it is not. It is completely defined using this functional equation. Now, using these two separate expressions, let's transform this plane. Let's draw the grid. And now, let's apply the zeta function. As you can see, that our incomplete contours are now completed using the method of analytic continuum, that is the functional equation, and it is truly beautiful. So now I hope you understand what it means. Now let's see the zeros of zeta function, which is very important. Up until now we have discussed what is zeta function. Now we will discuss the zeros of this zeta function, because the zeros are very important and they are related to Riemann's hypothesis. So we will consider this in three parts. First, we will consider the part where the real part of the z is less than zero. So for real component of s less than zero, we know that there the zeta function is defined using a functional equation. The equation is like this. Now for zeta of s to be zero, the sine term can be separately equals to zero, then the zeta will be zero. And for this sine term to be zero, we can write that the pi of s by 2 equals to n pi. And from this we can write s equals to 2n. Here n is any positive or negative integers. That is, n can be written as something like this. Now, here is another term, that is the gamma of 1 minus s. The gamma function is the extension of factorial, and I will later make a video on it. Now, this gamma function have some poles. The poles are the points where the function moves to infinity. So, the poles of gamma function are 0, 1, 2, 3. So, using this, we can write that the zeros of zeta function exist at s equals to minus 2n. Here, n is any positive integers, just positive integers. So, from this we can say that the zeros of the zeta function in the left side of the plane exist at negative even numbers. And these zeros are called trivial zeros. As you can see from the plot, I have plotted the mod of zeta function along the y-axis. Now let's discuss another region of zeros. Now let's consider the second region, that is the region for which the real part of z is greater than 1. In this region, the zeta function is defined as the infinite sum, that is the zeta of s equals to something like this. Now, using a little algebraic manipulation, we can write it using prime numbers. There, the zeta of s is written as something like this. Here, capital pi represent the continuous multiplication. Now, in this region, the zeta of s will be 0 when p to the power s is equals to 0. And there is not a single number which to the power a number equals to 0. So, in this region, there are no zeros. Now we will discuss the region where the real part of s is within 0 and 1. This region is called critical region, and there are many zeros of zeta function in this region. We will not discuss in much more detail for this region. I will just discuss the Riemann's hypothesis, which is related to this region. So let's see what Riemann hypothesis says. The Riemann hypothesis says that the zeros in this region, which are called the non-trivial zeros, that is the non-trivial zeros of Riemann zeta function, have the real part r of s equals to half. And in notation we can write it as zeta of half plus it equals to 0, where t is any complex number. Now to understand it, I will plot this function. Let's draw the complex plane. Now I will plot or draw the zeta function for the real part equals to half as a carb. Now, if that carb moves through the origin, that means the zeta function have zeros for the real part equals to half. So now let's draw it. That is the zeta function as a carb. Let's take a point and let's draw it. As you can see, we are drawing the curve and see that it moves through the origin and not just a single time. It is going through the origin many times. That means for the real part equals to half, there are many zeros of the zeta function as suggested by the Riemann's hypothesis. And this is what you have to prove. If you can prove it, $1,000,000 will be yours. So I hope you have understood it. Now let's see why these zeros are important. To understand why the zeros of zeta functions are important, let's define the prime counting function. This function is denoted by pi of x. And this means that the number of primes less than or equals to x. To understand it much better, let's take an example. Let's take x equals to 10. So we need to find out what pi of 10 is. Now, as we know that there are only 4 primes which are less than 10. Those primes are 2, 3, 4, 5 and 7. So there are only 4 primes. So pi of 10 equals to 4. I hope this is clear that pi of x represent the number of primes within a range. Now let's draw the graph of this function. Graphs always help. So I will place the prime counting function on y-axis, and in x-axis there are normal numbers. As you can see that the prime counting function is like a step function, and when we crosses a prime number, we goes up by one step. Well, it is obvious because when we passes a prime, we add one. As you can see, for 5, 11 and 23 they are prime, so we increase by 1, and for 27 it was just constant. Now my question is, if someone asks us to find a prime, a number of primes in a certain range like pi of 10 to the power 30, what can we do? How can we find it? To find it, we need a functional relation with x. And to find that, we need the zeros of zeta function. Let's see how. Now to describe the prime counting function as a function of x, we define another function, that is Riemann's prime counting function, which is denoted by j of x equals to something like this. Now one thing should be remembered, that this is not an infinite sum. To understand it, why it is not the case, let's take an example. Let's take x equals to 100. Now for x equals to 100, at some point the nth root of x will be less than 2, and at that point pi of that number equal to 0. Like an example, let's as you can see that pi of nth root of 100 will be equals to 0, and for this particular case, that is for 100, the n will be 7, because nth root of 100 is 1.9, which is less than 2. So it will be equals to 0. That is, the pi of any number less than 2 will be equals to 0. So now this function can be written using the Riemann zeros as something like this. Here li of x is a special function which is called the logarithmic integral and is defined as something like this. And the rho is the non-trivial zeros of Riemann zeta function. Now you understand why the zeros are very important. Now let's see how we can understand it in much better way. Now I have taken the axis and I will be plotting the pi of x and j of x in a single graph, something like this. And I have not included any zeros of the zeta function in the graph of j of x, that is the yellow one. Now remember the expression of j of x using the logarithmic integral function and the zeros of Riemann's zeta function, that is the non-trivial zeros. So j of x is something like this. And now what I will do, I will increase the number of zeros included in this formula for plotting the graph. So let's increase it one by one. As you can see, as I increase the number of zeros included, the j of x represent the pi of x very beautifully. And this is why the non-trivial zeros are so important. Now I hope that you have understood the concept of zeta function and its zeros and the Riemann hypothesis. So this is all for today, and goodbye, and visit our website for more.